Good evening. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Welcome to the Checkpoint. Today we are going to be looking at the post-election period. And our guest tonight is Dr. Frederick Golova Mutebi, an independent researcher. Dr. Golova, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Doctor, election observers, the East African Community, IGAD, and the African Union have largely described Uganda's election as peaceful and free of voter intimidation, albeit a few glitches here and there. Would you agree with them on that position?
Yes, I agree. Anyone who went out to vote would agree that the elections themselves were peaceful and orderly. I went to three different polling stations while looking for my name. And at all the three polling stations, there was no violence. The police were not armed. There were, I think, special police constables who were just guiding people where to queue up and answering questions. So yes, the elections were peaceful and quiet and free of intimidation. That is true.
But there are critics that have argued that that having a peaceful or quiet election per se does not necessarily mean that the population or the electorate was content with the way the process was conducted.
Yeah, of course. I think that once we move away from what happened on election day itself, and we examine the process from even before the campaigns began, that's where you begin to see problems or challenges with this just concluded election, just like any other that President Museveni has taken part in. Now, and this is where election observers can become really nonsensical in their pronouncements. If you say the elections were peaceful, of course they were peaceful. Because a government that wants to misbehave will not misbehave on the day of the voting itself. They misbehave before. The campaigns were very violent. Anyone, even supporters of the government, would agree. There was a lot of violence, there was a lot of intimidation, there was a lot of arrests of opposition supporters, and the entire campaign team of Bobi Wine was arrested, and as we speak, they're still in under custody. So the things that people are complaining about did not happen on election day. They happened before. And those are the things that election observers never see. They arrive a day or two before the elections happen, and they go and write their reports, you know, the elections were peaceful. Of course they were peaceful. What does that mean about, what does that say about the process leading up to the election itself?
The Constitution talks about a credible, free and fair election. It's the only type of election that it does envision. In your analysis, did we have a credible, free and fair election? That's including the processes.
No, we didn't. It wasn't free in the sense that opposition groups, and I'm not just talking of one, all of them, were not allowed the space to campaign as envisaged under the Constitution, as envisaged under Uganda's other laws. So that's one. In that case, it wasn't free. Was it fair? It can't be fair when presidential candidates who are contesting against the president are not allowed free rein. They are not allowed to campaign at the venues they have booked. They are not allowed access to radio stations where they have booked airtime to speak. They are not allowed access to media. They are pushed off main roads by the police and the army. That cannot be a credible election. So no, the answer is no. We didn't have a free or credible election.
But according to one of the candidates, now president-elect Yoweri Museveni, he said in one of the speeches immediately, I think after the election, that this was the freest and the most the fairest election that we've ever had since 1996 in the new constitutional order. And he tags that on the use of the electronic, the biometric voter verification system. So that means we had one man, one vote, and that is what the Constitution does envision.
Yeah, but still, I would go back to the question you raised in the beginning. What happened on election day? it was orderly and peaceful, and whoever turned up to vote, provided their name was on the register, they could vote. Of course, the voter machines malfunctioned in some instances, but that did not stop people from voting. What we are talking about in terms of examining whether this was a free, credible, and fair election is the process, the electoral process, the entire electoral process. There was nothing free about it, and I'm sure President Museveni knows this. I'm old enough to have been able to remember, or to be able to remember what happened in 1980. In 1980, on election day, one could say, well, those elections were peaceful on election day. But they were not peaceful. The process wasn't peaceful. President Museveni himself was arrested. Many of his colleagues were harassed. Members of the Democratic Party were harassed. Some of them were killed, just as happened during this recent electoral process. Now, as far as I remember, since President Museveni came to power, the most violent campaign before this previous one was the one of 2001. This one went beyond what we witnessed in 2001. Now, I don't know whether President Museveni was just overly enjoying his secluded campaign where he didn't probably know what was going on around him or wherever he wasn't. The fact of the matter is those of us who were observing what was happening across the country with regard to each and every candidate, there was nothing free or fair about this electoral process, nothing at all.
Throughout the entire process, the electoral process, one of the messages that has been coming out, including from religious leaders, has been that everyone should be able to observe peace. Everyone should drum up support for peace. That brings in mind the question of what leads to a peaceful environment. Should it necessarily be a peaceful environment, or the question of justice does miss? And if the question of justice does miss, why do the people that talk about peace then ignore the question of justice?
I think that the people who are calling for peace are motivated, first of all, by the fear of violence and its effects. I don't think that there is a Ugandan in their right mind who would want to see violence in this country. We've lived through enough violence. We need to go beyond that. But to simply concentrate on peace, you know, let's have peace, I think misses some very fundamental issues that we need to address in this country, one of which is the issue of violence. As we speak, violence is still going on around us. We hear reports of people being abducted, people being locked up arbitrarily. We've seen images of women crying because their sons or daughters have disappeared. You cannot start talking of peace when those things are happening. Peace is eventually undermined by that kind of behavior by the government. A government that is violating the law, the laws that it has made. A government that is supposed to preside over due process, that is supposed to respect rule of law. If it doesn't, eventually that will lead to a breakdown of peace. Now, all these religious leaders who are calling for peace, I think that some of them probably fear to talk out or to speak out against all the violations of rights that we are witnessing. But eventually, it's self-defeating. You can't just keep addressing peace. I mean, President Museveni went to the bush with his friends because of the rigged electoral process in 1980. What if everybody had been calling for peace? He would never have been able to get the support he got for the war that he waged against the government that was oppressing people here. So it surprises me that 40 years down the road, we are forgetting that the very conditions that forced President Museveni to go to the bush and wage a guerrilla war are now beginning to creep back. We see so many similarities between today and what happened in the early 1980s. And to just focus on peace and forget all the rights violations, all the violence, all the gratuitous suppression of people's rights, I think there's a mistake in that.
one of the reasons, I mean, what does it say for a leader? Because it seems like government is not remorse about what happened during the electoral process. And the justification is that the circumstances under which we were holding this election were not normal circumstances. So you had COVID-19, and it was detrimental for the populations to gather, and so it wasn't business as usual. Don't you think that's justification enough for the state, because it has a role, quote unquote, to protect the people and including their health?
Look here, President Museveni first participated in an election after he came to power in 1996. Now that was the first post-war presidential campaign. And I was out in the countryside. I was in southwest Uganda. I was in the Masaka Chotara region. There was violence then. Paul Ssemwogere was not always allowed to hold rallies. Paul Ssemwogere's supporters were being harassed in 1996. In 2001, same thing. We saw people being knocked by military vehicles here in Weyogere. We saw Kakoza Mutale and his Kalangal Action Plan. Was there COVID at the time? There was no COVID. You remember Kalangal Action Plan? Mm. You remember General Tumukunde when he was head of ISO? You remember the things he said in 2001? That, oh, you know, the guns we used to fight to capture power are still there. We can still use them. So the excuse of COVID almost assumes that we Ugandans are stupid or something. Every single election campaign we have had in this country since President Museveni came to power has been characterized by obstruction of opposition candidates from holding rallies. It has been characterized by harassment of their supporters. It has been characterized by violence against their supporters each and every single election. So let's not use COVID as some kind of cover for what has happened. This campaign has been the most violent we have seen so far. But each and every campaign we've had in this country, each and every presidential campaign has been violent. The degrees of violence have differed, but it's been there all the time. So COVID is an excuse that only those who were sleeping through the process would accept.
So we are still where we were in 1980. We are still where we were in probably 1966. Should the quest for democracy in Uganda cost human life?
Well, I'm not sure I would agree with you that we are still where we were. I think a lot has changed. The means that the government uses to rig election or to subvert electoral process, they keep changing. But if you want to say that we are still where we are in terms of building a democratic system, yeah, of course, we still haven't moved very much towards building a democratic system where every competitor for power has the space and the freedom to compete freely and fairly. No, that we haven't done. And for me, I think that this is where we really should be putting President Museveni and his group on the spot. Because when they went to the bush in 1980-81, they went because they had been victims of a system that did not believe in holding free and fair elections, that believed in subverting the electoral process, that did not believe in rule of law. So when they went to the bush, they promised that once they took power, they would behave differently. And for us who were here, or at least who were old enough to know what happened, to see these same things happening under President Museveni's government, that is shocking, and that is very, very disappointing for those of us who believed that we would never live to see things of that kind again.
You cite the 1996 election. Some experts argue that President Museveni would have comfortably won the 1996 election. So in my mind, I'm like, what informs the decision to hold elections under such conditions? Why would we have violence in an election that you can comfortably win? What informs this kind of behavior?
Well, I'm sure there are many reasons, but as far as I'm concerned, I think that President Museveni has never been confident of winning a free and fair election. I think he's terrified of elections. Even as he promised us that we would have elections and he wants to build a democracy, It doesn't seem to me as if he's a very confident person when it comes to political competition. He must make, well, he must take steps to ensure that in addition to him campaigning, in addition to him trying to convince people to vote for him, there must be other ways of ensuring that he wins. And of course, he does that by blocking access by opposition leaders to the population. He does that by denying them access to the media. He does that by not allowing them to convene meetings. All those things add up to advantages that favor his chances of winning. So I think it's something to do with President Museveni himself. And it's something to do, in my opinion, with the party he leads, thinking that somehow they have the right to lead this country and no one else has it. Now, I have been reading things on social media suggesting that now people are calling for reconciliation between President Museveni and the opposition. What are they reconciling over?
That's where I was going. But before we go on the question of reconciliation, if you have a leader who controls the state machinery as it is, money and then instruments of coercion, and they are not confident of winning an election, then why should we go into an election then? I mean.
Well, I think that there is a difference, say, between holding a flawed election and winning it and staging a coup. If you stage a coup, you're outrightly committing illegalities. If you stage an election where you allow minimal space to your competitors to compete, but then you rig so many other processes and you put obstacles in their way and you still win it, the international community will accept it, even if they do so grudgingly. At least formally, you have won an election. Mm. It's not the same thing if President Museveni woke up tomorrow and declared a state of emergency or conducted a coup and said we will not have elections in Uganda, then that would be very different from what is happening. For some reason, even flawed elections do gain legitimacy after the tempers have cooled down. People move on. He will remain president. The international community must have somebody in Uganda to deal with. And that is going to be President Museveni, unfortunately. So in that way, we may feel dissatisfied with the process and how it has unfolded, but the fact of the matter is he has been declared the winner by the Electoral Commission. It's very unlikely that the courts are going to reverse this, even as the opposition or part of the opposition has gone to court to challenge it. So eventually he's going to be president of Uganda, the UN, the African Union, all international actors are going to have to deal with him. So. And of course, they're not going to spend all their time trying to question what happened here. They have other things to do. So in that sense, yeah, a flawed election is better than a coup.
One of the rhetorics on what you've been discussing has been, if a flawed election is better than a coup. So by and large, we've had elections that do not meet the standards that are set in our law books. But you have, for example, in Chira municipality, you have Honorable Semju Nganda winning now for the third time. In Mukono, you have Honorable Betty Namboze. You have more than a half of a new entrant, the National Unity Platform, sweeping the entire region, almost 61 MPs. So, I mean, if it is a flawed process, how are these MPs able to come up, because they elected on the same day anyway? On the day you vote for the president is the day you vote for the area MP. So how come they do not cheat out Honorable Semju Nganda, but then Museveni's opponents are cheated out?
I think that when you look at MPs, you really to understand, for instance, why Semju was elected in Kira. There must be local factors playing into this. You may find that even NRM supporters in his constituency voted for him because they like him as a person, maybe because he's ineffective as a legislator. And for that reason, they say, oh, well, we will keep him because he's a good MP. Now, at the presidential level, they will go and vote for somebody else. But also, I think one thing that we have to understand is that even a government that is most adept at rigging cannot rig each and every position. There are limitations to, or there are limits to rigging. Now, in the regions where President Museveni lost, Buganda and Busoga, there must have been factors that really incensed people to such an extent that they decided they would not vote for President Museveni. And given the strength of feeling, say, in Buganda, and I think that for me in Buganda what happened was, I mean, there were many factors, but I think that the violence that we saw being committed against Bobi Wine and his supporters and the sheer abuse of the electoral process must have annoyed a lot of people. You know, people are going around saying, you see, Bobi Wine is being supported by young people and older people are supporting President Museveni. Let's assume that is true, that the younger people who are supporting President Museveni then are turned on by the military, by the police, they are arrested, they are harassed, they are shot at, they are killed. These people have parents. So the older people who are supposed to be President Museveni's supporters are there looking at their own children being brutalized. You do not expect them to go ahead and vote for the same person who is brutalizing their children. So that must have played into this. And as you can see, almost all NRM MPs in Uganda were wiped out. So I think that that was a reaction. That was an immediate reaction to other factors that were playing into the electoral process. Now, in areas where, and people will tell you that in areas where the president has a lot of support, it is easier to rig elections there because almost everybody supports him. In areas where hostility towards him is so high, it means that maybe the largest percentage of people in that region are against him. So who are you going to convince to take part in the rigging? So in that case, they will not attempt to rig in areas where their popularity is so small. But they'll go and rig where the popularity is high, because then there is space for rigging. So that's what explains people like Nambozi, people like Semuju. They're operating in localities where local factors play in their favor.
You highlight some of the factors that probably could have informed the voting pattern, say, in Buganda and Busoga. But I would say Chagulanyi had more time campaigning outside Buganda than he did in Buganda, because in the last run to the elections, actually, the Electoral Commission phased out campaigning in most districts in Buganda, where presumably Chagulanyi has more support. So are you saying the people, say, in northern Uganda and western Uganda, where he spent most time, are aloof to the violence that was going on around his team?
They may not be aloof, but I think what happened is the violence affected or impacted directly on families in Uganda and possibly Busoga than it did in the north. Remember the war against the LRA in the north. How many of us in the south were feeling what was happening in the north personally?
We probably don't have an idea.
I mean, it was so far away from where we are, and there were other factors also playing into this. So if you go to Acholi and you listen to the Acholis about what happened during the war, when they started voting against President Museveni before the recent election where they changed, they were voting because of that. It was the impact of the violence that they suffered during the war against the LRA that really so turned them against the NRM government and President Museveni that they, for many years, they couldn't bring themselves to voting for him. For us in the South, we were happily voting for him in spite of what was happening in the North, because we didn't feel it. It was not our families involved. It was not our relatives being displaced. We were here having a nice time in the South, and we cared very little about what was going on in the North. 4 years ago, when there was a massacre in Kasese, how many of us in Kampala or in Buganda took this as an issue for us? It wasn't for us. It was their issue. It was in Kasese. It was so far away. We didn't even understand what the issues were. Now, Bobi Wine was campaigning a lot outside of Uganda, but the fact of the matter is the vast majority of his campaign team, the vast majority of the young people he was moving around with, were from Uganda. Many of them were from Busoga, because it seems to me as if for some reason Noop got a very positive reaction from young people in Busoga. So these young people were from two regions, and so their brutalization in Gulu, in Nebi, in Koboko, in Karamoja, was impacting directly on the feelings of people here, because their parents are here, their relatives are here, their relatives are in Busoga. So these people are watching their children being brutalized. So, and in many ways, I think that even if people outside Uganda were seeing the same thing, it wasn't having the same impact as it was having here, in the same way that the LRA war didn't have the same impact outside of the Acholi or Greater Northern Area. That's how the events in Kasese did not really impact on us in the way that they impacted on people in that region. So it is that we tend to feel pain in a very localized way, because we only do so if it is impacting on us directly. Otherwise, we don't.
Is it just the pain, or we also pick on campaign issues in a localized way?
Well, I think that we pick on campaign issues in a localized way only for members of parliament, or mainly for members of parliament, not for the presidency. For the presidency, the local issues become important if something really drastic has happened within a particular region. Again, I go back to the LRA war. In Teso, when we had the Arrow Boys there and the instability in Teso, they were not voting for President Museveni at the time. They were voting FDC. So President Museveni has dealt successfully with the violence in the north and pacified the region. I don't know what he did to the people of Kasese after they had committed the massacres they committed there. I don't know how they were able to reverse the ill feelings of the people of that region to vote for him. He was able to pacify Teso, and of course he's been rewarded. West Nile, the same thing. He got rid of all the violence there and allowed people to get on with their life. So they are grateful for that. Now what has happened is that of recent in Uganda, the Baganda are beginning to feel under siege. In Busoga, there are so many grievances to do with the socio-economic conditions, the sugar cane, and so on and so forth. So the president becomes affected electorally if there are specific issues happening in a particular region that impact on people very directly.
Moving on, if I may ask, do institutions such as cultural institutions and the church have a role to play in organization of the politics of a society?
They may not have a role to play in the organization of politics, but they do have a role to play in as far as moderating the behavior of politicians is concerned, or as far as influencing the opinions of ordinary people is concerned. Now, this is not just in Uganda. The Catholic Church, or the churches or religious bodies in general, have always been at the forefront of political change. Now, once they begin to say certain things, or once they begin to behave in certain ways, their followers listen to them very carefully. I have heard President Museveni and supporters of his government condemning the Catholic Church for being partisan, condemning the Buganda monarchy, and so on and so forth. I'll take you back to the 80s. President Museveni received a lot of support from the churches or the religious bodies. The Catholic Church was very instrumental in helping Museveni to conduct his war. And that again had to do with their own disaffection with the Obote government at the time. And if he got their support and he was grateful for it, he should acknowledge that if today they are turning against him, there is something fundamentally wrong with his government. And he should be addressing that particular thing that the church is reacting to, rather than lashing out at the church.
You see, he argues that why probably he took up arms against Amin and subsequently Obote was because of that very reason, that initially they were part of the problem. They created this problem. Ugandan politics had become sectarian, it had become tribal, political parties were aligned to churches or religious leaders per se. So they were part of the problem, therefore they had to contribute to resolving the problem. Now that the problem was resolved, the question of ideological differences in terms of tribes and religions was settled in the 1980s or so. They now have to sit aside and look as he governs and the people that are interested in governance other than cultural institutions.
No, actually not. But to claim that the problems of sectarianism in Uganda have been solved is a bit dishonest. What has been resolved, as far as I'm concerned, one of President Museveni's greatest contributions to politics in this country is to have detached politics from direct association with religion, in the sense that we now don't have political parties with which we associate with particular religions or particular religious groupings. Now that he has been very successful at that. But for him to claim that somehow the problems of sectarianism and tribalism have been resolved, no, they haven't. They haven't. Actually, Uganda, even as we speak today, we see Uganda becoming, the manifestations of ethnic feeling, the manifestations of sectarianism are there. Why are people complaining about there being so many Westerners in the civil service? Why are people complaining about the army or the UPDF being Western dominated? Why are people complaining about regional police commanders being from the same region? People wouldn't be complaining about this if the problem of sectarianism had been resolved. No, it hasn't. I was following developments on social media. One of the things that people were complaining about was that Bobi Wine and his group were being harassed mainly by police officers who had Western-sounding names. Whether they were in Karamoja or in Acholi, it was Byarugava, Byaruhanga, Aine, so and so. Why are people still complaining about this if we have resolved the issue of sectarianism? We haven't. President Museveni's government is associated with a very particular region in this country, in the same way that Obote's was, in the same way that Amin's government was. Amin's government was dominated by West Nilers. Obote's was dominated by Northerners. President Museveni is dominated by Westerners. Everybody can see that. So to what extent can he claim that he has successfully resolved this problem? So the problems we have in this country, politically speaking, are not simply problems of ideology. No. There are problems of identity, there are problems of so many other things. So no, we haven't resolved the problem. And for him to now claim that, you know, religious groupings should stand aside and just watch as things happen, no. Churches and religious groups are the conscience of the masses. They have followers. Churches are not led by robots. They are led by human beings. They have relatives who are in politics, who are outside of politics. They have views. So today, as we speak, I think that their views are beginning to reflect more and more the views of a growing portion of the population in this country. So we should not pretend about that.
But Doctor, we are going to go for a very short break, but when we return, you will help us understand whether the NRM hasn't been able to successfully alienate the rise of the National Unity Platform and Robert Kyagulanyi as a Muganda Catholic who should be maintained in that area.